But some countries are twice than that already. Some countries, particularly liberal democracy, Russia is far ahead. United States also is very better. So what is the criteria of 222 is a good question to find out, but one will have to go back to that research. I don't have that figure of JNK right now. But if you go to the DPRD website, you might get it. Because I picked up those states which are abnormally low. But I can tell you they'll be good. The figure proportion in Jammu Kashmir, if you combine the armed forces and the paramilitary and the local police, it'll be probably as good as Nagaland. And as I told you, Nagaland is 1:65. It could be equally good. It means that could be the close ratio.
Madam, we talk about the agency.
Take a mic, please.
We talk about the 1861 police things that were there. And so far that 1861 police things have not been reformed. And we still continue with that 1861 police things. So then, in case if we are not able to reform the 1861 Police Act or whatever we had that time, and still not so far reforming it, doesn't it lead to more unchecking of corruption in our country?
Well, corruption is not linked with the Act of 1861. Corruption is linked with one's own, the character change in this country. But it's a shame that we're still on 1861 Act. It's quite a shame. It's quite a shame. And it's the Supreme Court also said, I was part of the drafting committee of the new model bill, which was submitted to Government of India 2 years ago. It's probably lying somewhere again in gathering dust. It's called the Model Police Act of 2008. Soli Sarabji was the chairman of that committee, and many of the retired and capable police professionals and bureaucrats and law professors were a part of that committee. So there is nothing we hear about it. So the act remains as it is. In fact, the central government could lead the way. Central government could lead the way by enacting a new law and replacing the Act of 1861. And that was a national act. So you can't say policing is a state subject, so let the states come up with their own act. Let them. But central government can lead the way by coming up with the central law. After all, Delhi police has an act. But there is you need to replace the Act of 1861, which was a central law, by a new law. It can be done. But we don't hear about it. As I told you, two very important groups which will bring police reforms, business and media. But business is minding only its own business. And media is also managing its own media. That's it. So there is nobody for police reforms in this country in a sustained way. Media picks up only when it makes sensational news, but not as a crusade for police reforms. So there is nobody, no crusade in our country. And media has to play an important role, but media has its own limitations in taking up certain crusades. So that is why we are left where we are.
Hello, excuse me. Now, I'm...
Take the mic, please.
Yeah. I'm Dr. Bist. I'm the secretary in charge of this university. I welcome you and thank you very much for this enlightening and really enlightened all of us.
Thank you.
But while doing MBA program from IGNU, I had a project on human audit. I wanted to do a police auditing, human audit. I approached a number of my police friends, certain DCPs. I went to PHQ, I went to SHOs, I went to PCRs. And my basic idea was that so many PCRs, 500 to 600, into so many policemen, so much radio networking, so many police stations. And I wanted a basic police auditing. But wherever I went, including my very good classmate who is a police officer, today is very senior officer, they all discouraged me. They said nothing, kuch nahi hoga. To apna kuch aur kar le, you won't get anything. I don't know why. I still don't have any answer to it. They could not answer my question. And I support you what you said in earlier, that policeman knows his face and they know how to write down and what to talk and what to do. Will you please? why they denied me? I tried to Since I'm in Delhi, I went to SHOs, I went to where I stay, I went to local SHOs, I went to PCRs, PSUs, but everybody say, isko mat karo, ye dimag khara ho jayega tumhara, you will get nothing. And I changed.
The problem is that you get so much that you won't know where to stop.
But they bluntly denied me. Anyway.
So they denied, you know, if you stay on at it, you get it.
But
use the ignow stick. Saying, yeh karoge, toh pata na, I can complain to my vice chancellor. And the vice chancellor then straight away has a phone call away to the president of India. Aap nahi chhodna, aap pata chal gaya.
I think we should do it now. Thank you.
Please carry on if you can.
Thank you. I think we should do it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, hear you. It's really enlightening to hear you. And we got knowledge about the functioning of police and other aspects. But I'm happy to see you among us is a sign of an Indian throbbing democracy. You were excluded from the police, but Indian democracy and other institutions are accommodating you. That's a very positive sign for the growth of Indian democracy. That's what
And Indian society.
Indian society. Of course, democratic society, and that's the message we are getting it. And that's the hope for India. And since you are, and I see you very fine that you are passionate, that you are still energetic, and you are doing.
What do you mean by still?
Reformist technique. Reformist. You are doing reformist activities. You have not lost your heart anyway. Reformist activities in the society.
Despite the still, you are still talking.
Please.
Carry on.
Now come to the point that.
I'm still listening.
I come to a point that in a democracy, since you have lot of knowledge, you know why there should be police to begin with.
So what's your question, sir?
Individuals surrender some rights to.
I'm still asking for your question.
Question is that somewhere within the form, what you are doing, within the form, it's fine. But when you are cross out things of solving the problems, then it ultimately boils to political in a democratic society. If the political parties or political system does not come to that level, we will be lot of effort will be wasted in many other aspects doing such things which will lead to not much results.
So what's your question?
Question is state. Somewhere possibly you are very well read, but you are very less read.
So what's your question?
The question is, did you still got the question more? The question is, madam, there's need to understand the modern functioning of democratic state. That's
the question.
That's the question.
Please put it in a question form.
The question form is that, do you know the modern function of the democratic state? Its institutions, their relevance, and in their importance, and where they are placed, and what role they can play.
Right, sir.
And can you make it with the present Indian democratic state? If democratic state is functioning.
Got your question, sir. Got it. Very good. Good question. Thank you. Got it.
I think we just have time for just one more last question.
Yes, take the mic, please. Can I just briefly respect the question by giving a short answer?
Sure.
Can I?
I just want to.
No, I have not answered. So you talked about understanding the political scenario in a functioning democracy. If that's your question, do I understand or does the system understand? I understand.
It's not my question.
All right, then what's your question?
I think we have still time for that.
Now I take that mistake. You are taking with me, asking repeatedly, what's your question? Now I take that question.
So maybe we could continue with this.
I'm
question.
Sorry, I don't understood your question. Next question. Thank you very much.
Can you please suggest some measures how crime against women can be, reduced? Because we are not safe in the house, outside house, be it urban area or be it rural areas.
So preventive measures. The safety for women or crimes against women issue or safety for women is not separate from overall safety perspective. You cannot have security for women and insecurity generally. It is an integral part of good governance and good policing and good criminal justice systems and good society. Nothing is in isolation. You cannot have a corrupt society or a gender biased society and bad governance and corrupt policing and have women secure. It cannot be. Security of women is a part of cultural security. You see a big difference between how women feel secure in certain parts of India and do not feel secure in other parts of India. The policing is the same. Political governance pattern is the same. Indian democracy is the same. But culturally we are different. So therefore, without mentioning the regions where I do know that there's a class where women do feel securer than in certain other parts of the region. A lot comes out of cultural background. However, good policing and good governance, both, and even good civil society, good education, better youth, helps in enhancing women's security. And even women, how they conduct themselves, how they perform, how they deliver, what kind of confidence they show, I think even their culture plays a role. Because crimes against women are also perpetrated by sometimes women. So therefore it's a part of the entire milieu and culture of that society where policing and governance plays a role. But only good policing will not provide good security for women. That's important. So,
recently, certain states have come with women police stations.
Yeah.
Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and all.
Yes.
So, how much this women police station has reformed the police system, especially with respect to women safety?
Well, this is subject for study, because I can only give you my subjective answer. This is exactly the questions which we need to study. But that's true. Women policing ratio is highest in Tamil Nadu from the rest of the country. If you look at if Indian police women have women ratio in India out of this 1.7 million, women police is just 45,000. Out of these 45,000, more than half belong to Tamil Nadu or that region, southern region. So that's a very substantial number. And women are in higher positions, deputy superintendents of police and at inspectors and opening more women police stations. What has happened is, this is a personal impression, it's not a researched answer, is that most of these women don't have powers. They're there, but they're basically toothless and powerless. The real resources are still in the hands of the men. So they're more of counselors. They're more of as first interveners, as first responders. But I think what they're still not given is freedom of action. But that's true that wherever you have a women police station, women do feel encouraged to go to a police station and make a complaint. So it is good in the long run. However, how effective they are is still in the hands of the supervisors who happen to be men.
One very last question, please. One last question, and then you'll have time to interact with Dr. Bedi over tea, please.
No, I want my tea to myself. Finish your questions now.
Madam, congratulations to you for a very enlightening lecture. But I want your reaction, because the police, according to me, has a notorious record. If I have to give one example, last week it was shown on TV. Amethi constituency, Hardoi Thana police station, the SHO beat up a woman in the police station so notoriously, entire country was watching. This is, you know, the police crime and the police for which it was created British time. So time and again, I don't want to repeat this, but, you know, the police is meant for the, you know, the purpose, as if, you know, it is, you know, the against, you know, the citizens are the, you know, not for the safety and security of the people. The another example I want your comment in Bhopal on the Valentine Day, two couples were sitting in the restaurant, but the boy who was inside and he was just coming out, and the eight of the policemen caught hold of that boy, and he was publicly beaten up with the huge lathis, and it was very chaotic. It was, you know, so disturbing to the whole nation. Please comment.
Thank you for the order. Please comment. What are you? Are you a policeman? Listen, so for a while I'm your student, you're telling me, please comment. Let me comment, please. This is part of dehumanizing. What you saw is a subculture which prevails over a period and dehumanizes these policemen. There's an answer to this. Why is this happening, dehumanizing? Is for years and years, they've left only to do what they're doing. And they are like, they're literally being kicked from above and little below. This is a subculture of policing which you have witnessed. How do you break this subculture? And this subculture happens. Do you remember Rodney King's case in USA? Where it was shot in camera for the first time, the world saw it, when Rodney King, a black, who was beaten by sticks by white policemen on the road, and it was shot on camera, and the world saw it, it was called the Rodney King case. It was exactly the same, dehumanizing of the policemen. Now, when in and out you only do that, just as you ordered me to speak, because you're a teacher who orders the students. You see, that's your culture now. You order your students, because the students can't come back to you saying, sir, please be polite. See? So, that's your subculture. This is the subculture. Nobody can be blamed, because we are living in that subculture and we get habituated, and nobody takes us away from that and even sensitizes us to say, this is what's happening, please change and amend. So, what I'm trying to say, what has certain state, what have foreign countries done? They take away the policeman after a few years to say compulsory study leave. Go and study. They keep a budget of education budget in their police budgets and say after so many years you have to return to the university. Go and sit as an ordinary student, travel as an ordinary in an ordinary bus which is meant for people, become an ordinary citizen. So from extraordinary ordinary authority, you become an ordered society. So go back to the community. Unless we do that, which is so difficult. At the moment, leaves are cancelled, as you see, at the drop of a hat. The training is only probably once in a lifetime. There are no training institutions. So there is no resensitization. It's only dehumanizing. There's no resensitization. How did we people retain our sanity? It's resensitization is critical. How some of us in these leadership services retained our sensitivity? By working with the NGOs, by continue to educate, by continue to write, by continue to interact with the community and work. Now why? Because we could have the luxury of doing that. We seniors could have the luxury. Those don't have the luxury. This is their bread and butter. They are living away from homes and families for months together. Ask them, why are you in this job? Bache paalne sab. So, there is no resensitization happening in these sensitive positions. So, friends, this is what happens. He does not re-educate himself 24/7. He's like a human machine. Ye chor pakda, ye mara, ye workout kiya, ye salute mara, ye maine traffic mein usko VIP ko control kiya. That's all his language. So all he does is use his shortcut. I'm not justifying, but it's dehumanizing. You want to humanize people? You have to take them back from that culture and give them some leave. Go home, celebrate festivals. No festival does a policeman celebrate. Policeman celebrates no festival with his family. Every time there's a festival, policeman is duty. Otherwise, how do you celebrate Diwali? How do you celebrate Christmas and New Year? How do you celebrate Holi? How do you celebrate the New Year? No policeman worth it is in his house, he's out on the road. His family never celebrates it with his own approval. So with the result, it's dehumanizing. So therefore, my friend, we need to understand why it's happening. Many times when I'm asked on the television, come here and explain, I said, you won't be understanding what has happened. I want to explain to you why it has happened. Are you interested? The media is not interested in the why. The media is only interested in the what. So this is where you people, or you as citizens watching programs, do not get sensitized to the why. You only get sensitized to, or rather angry on the what. And that's why you were so angry. And I'm glad you were angry. I'm glad it's still making you angry. Because this is about democracy. This is about enlightened citizenship. Thank you very much.
And Dr. M.V. Lakshmirajiram, instead of raising issues and problems, I wanted to place before you one proposal for consideration, not only you, entire audience, and through you and the audience to the constitutional authorities. All these problems will have a solution when there is integration of this policing system under the courts. Can we have courts in the police stations itself, because people are afraid of going to the court. Nobody is ready to go to the court and spend time and wait there for hours together. So is there any possibility of setting up the courts in the police stations itself, so that they can comfortably attend in the local police stations without fear of torture by even the criminals against whom the complainant has made the complaint? So could you please comment upon it, and also convince the constitutional authorities to integrate this police and judicial systems?
I'm afraid I would not go along with this suggestion. I would let the courts remain away from the police stations. But what I would love to see, police reforms are not separate from judicial reforms. And, policing is less researched. And, least research is judicial performance. Today, the least researched is judicial performance. Thank you for bringing this out. Policing is commented upon, all right? Commented upon, angered upon, right? Dismissed and corrected upon, all right? So at least there is a debate on it. But on judicial reforms, there's no debate. And it's never ever assessed, not audited, not corrected. In fact, police reforms will not happen, thank you for pointing it out, will not happen till you also have judicial reforms. Because if even when I, as a policeman, do a good job, it comes to a knot with delayed justice. With so much of delay in the justice system that, and the insecure justice system, that with the result that I lose faith I am the one who is a victim as a police officer, because the visible face of law enforcement is the police. So they say, koi fayda nahi inke paas jaane ka, pakad bhi lenge, chalan bhi karenge, saza to honi nahi, kyunki saza to kisi aur ne deni. Jahan mera witness bhi theek hai, jahan mera taftish bhi theek hai, lekin usko bhi 10 saal lag rahe hai saza dene mein, aur 10 saal ke baad bhi 2 saal ki saza hai, 6 mahine de do. 2 saal se 6 mahine de do. This is Mr. Rathore's case. Kiska kasoor hai? Policeman ने गलती की, लेकिन आपने सजा भी जब देने लगे तो फिर 2 साल से 6 महीने क्यों की, फिर 2 साल तो दे दो, वो भी नहीं दी. So unless we have judicial reforms, it is going to impact on police trust and faith. Thank you. Let's have this as the last question.
Can I have one last question, please?
This is dependent on noble police like you. But right from my childhood, I was given the thought that policemen are with sunken, drunken eyes, with bellies put forward, and there are criminals among police also. So we are, feeling that much afraid to go near the police for giving any complaint. Having educated to this much also, I am still afraid to go near the police and ask for any help. So how can we overcome our fear, or what is the measure taken to identify the criminals among the police? Is there any measure taken by the government, or
it's does they get exposed by themselves by getting caught one day? They do get caught. Nature takes over and they do get caught. But then in the process, they do a lot of harm in criminalization.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm afraid we're running out of time.
One simple question.
All right, sir. Just a minute, please. Thank you very much. Excuse me.
inspiring to listen to you, and what I got it is that it's very difficult. It is very difficult to conduct research in the police.
Correct.
That's what Captain Bishit was also
That's
saying.
That's true.
And it's very difficult. They don't answer and it will be very difficult. If IGNO initiates research,
good.
Will you come forward to for us to get that research done in the
police? Sir, you have a right to information now.
Yeah.
Use the RTI.
No, I'm saying, will Dr. Kiran Bedi help us in doing that? Because your image before them is different than a common man.
Your name
for us, they will make us run away.
I can assure you, moment you say you're a student from IGNOW, and IGNOW is behind you, and you also have the RTI, you don't need any...
If I'm saying that I'm doing it together with Dr. Kiran Bedi, will it make a difference?
May not. But if you say IGNOW, it will. So I think use IGNOW and RTI.
Yes. Since Dr. Bedi would like to have her tea all by herself without being pestered by questions, maybe she would welcome questions over the email.
Email, yes.
And I'm sure aapko bahut mehenga pada, because there have been so many questions and there are so many people still eager to stand up and make their comments.
Sure, please go ahead. Most welcome.
I am deaf. And I have, many of my friends have asked me, okay, that the police people, when we travel in the train or anybody, the police people, they catch us. Because we are deaf, we can't communicate. We tell them we will write and communicate with you, but still they ill-treat us, and they say, yes, you can speak, you are pretending. So how do you solve that? Because we face this problem every day.
This is so sad. I don't know whether this training is being given at all in the police training. How to deal with the people with disabilities. It is sad. I don't think there is a part of a training course. I'm not aware of this kind of heightened sensitivity. This is amazing. This is an area which is absolutely absent. Handling people with disability, whether visual or hearing or otherwise. But I certainly understand their anxiety. Yes, policemen might say, tum jhoot bol rahe ho, tum mujhe sun rahe ho, jaan ke nahi sun rahe, kyunki suits them. Well, 1 in 100 can lie, but they can, why not give the benefit of doubt to the person concerned? But I think this is talking about sensitivity, which is, as I said, even if it's a theoretical part of the beginning course, but there's no resensitization taking place. Because there are no spare people to go for training. Nobody spared, chutti kaat dete hai, training kahan se bhejenge? This is a very serious matter, I'm telling you. Ye sab policemen aaj inke paas agar option hoti, koi police wala police mein kaam na karta, kahin aur jata. Uska option hi nahi hai, ek bari naukri mein aaya, phas jata hai. Because bus ka dusri naukri ke liye employable hi nahi banta. Once a policeman joins, he is unemployable for anything else. So he has nothing, no other option but to carry on with this. There is no, that's true, he's stuck. He's stuck, he does not have an option. Tell me a 12th standard constable or a graduate only, sub-inspector or police, who would employ him from a department and give him this kind of salary and sense of security? Because an ordinary police constable costs the government not less than 20,000 rupees a month. Because he gets clothing, he gets housing, 30% get housing, he gets travel, he gets medical free, he's insured, his whole family is medically covered, and his carry home salary after the 6th pay commission is about, let's say, 10,000 rupees a month. And look at all those, it's 20,000. If I say 20,000, that's also low. Who will employ a 12th standard boy or a woman for 20,000? So what does he do? He sticks to the job. He doesn't have an option. But he's dehumanized over a period, he's not retrained, his potential is not taken, he's not made much more relevant and more current and relevant for the people. So with the result that he becomes what you saw. The fault is in the department in human resource management. There is no HR department in police department. Do you know this? You have HR everywhere. Give me one post I can recall when there's a human resource inspector general, human resource. Must be Karnataka or somewhere only. One of the southern states. Nowhere is Delhi police itself is 70,000 plus. It does not have special commissioner human resource. There is no human resource development as such. We have special commissioner training, but no concept of human resource yet. So my Hyderabad maybe. So these southern states could be, but there is no concept of human resource development. So they not looked at it as a human being, they now looked at it as a human machinery to deliver. So that is the reason this is happening. This is a very serious issue. This is remaining unaddressed, but it's addressed by respective DGPs of the states. It all depends who is leading the force. If you have a sensitive leader, you have this. If you have a very different kind of leader, you don't have it. You have a man like him, it's different. See, IGNOU will go through changes too. You will have a different priority, different kind of style and management. Everybody comes with their own leadership and management style. So that is why they suffer because of this. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm sure you're not going to forget this evening in a hurry, but lest you forget, we'd like to give you a small memento of your visit. a very small token of our gratitude and remembrance.
Thank you. I've never seen ever a vice chancellor sitting through the lecture. I've never seen this. Never, sir. Never, not even a director of an institute sits through the lecture. And you have found the time to sit through this whole thing. Sir, I'm very, very grateful to you. Thank God. I wish we had more people like you in this country.
Thank you. May I now request Dr. Salima Nanda, the director of the International Division of the IGNOU, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Honorable Madam Kiran Bedi, Chief Speaker and Chief Guest of the Silver Jubilee Lecture, esteemed Vice Chancellor and Chairperson of the meeting, Professor V. N. Rajasekharan Pillai, respected Pro Vice Chancellor and Coordinator of Silver Jubilee Lecture, Dr. Lata Pillai, my colleague, Professor Shri Krishna Devara, discussant, assembled dignitaries, Pro Vice Chancellors, members of the academic community of IGNOU, and ladies and gentlemen. I was excitedly waiting for this felicitous moment to arrive when I get the proud privilege to propose a vote of thanks. Like all good things in life, even this absorbing speech delivered has come to an end. Madam Bedi's address on welfare, preventive policing and helping the helpless needed a very sensitive touch as it is concerned with the ethical and normative aspects of policing. One has to go beyond the limits of Indian Penal Code, Criminal Procedure Code and other laws to enter the arena of police reforms and understand the bottom reality of policing in our country. It needs a large heart full of subtle compassion and penetrative insight to understand human nature. Very few speakers would have done justice to the subject as you have done, ma'am. We are very fortunate to have you in our midst today. Ample wisdom may be available, but there won't be many who translate this wisdom into real actions in daily life. Rightly, I am reminded of the words of Abraham Lincoln, "If there is no cause to die, there is no cause to live." Today, you have given a cause for which we can dedicate and devote ourselves. Thanks for such lofty thoughts of yours, ma'am. On behalf of IGNOU and on my personal behalf, I extend my heartiest gratitude for finding time from your busy schedule and share your experiences with us. To quote you, ma'am, "I put my head and heart in each piece I wrote, and after doing so, I felt like a bird free to fly." Perhaps we should also imbibe the true spirit of such an expression. Thank you, ma'am. From the stage of envisioning the Silver Jubilee Lecture to the stage of materialization today, we have been inspired by the constant guidance of the grand mentor of our university, our Honorable Vice Chancellor. Your positivism and indefatigable energy have taught us lessons to persevere, and finally the perseverance has paid. Einstein once said, "It's not that I'm so smart, it's just that I stay with the problem longer." Sir, you have taught us to stay longer with the nagging issues and enable us to achieve. On behalf of all, I convey my sincere gratitude to you for your benign support and constant guidance at all stages. Thank you, sir. We have been fortunate to work for the lecture under the leadership of Pro Vice Chancellor Dr. Lata Pillai. She has allowed us to encroach on her time liberally whenever requested. It is her management and her eye for details which have taught us to excel. I am indeed grateful to you, ma'am. My thanks to the discussant, my colleague, Professor Sri Krishna Deva Rao, for critically giving an overview of the perspective of Madam Bedi's lecture. I'll be failing in my duty if I leave out mentioning my gratitude to the Director AMPC and his team, who have provided the technical backup for beautifully arranging this function. I am thankful to all my colleagues of the organizing Silver Jubilee Lecture Committee, convener Dr. Babu Ramesh and other support staff who have offered their sincere cooperation for organizing the seminar. The help rendered by the Administrative Division, Horticulture Cell, Security and CPWD needs special mention. I thank all of you. My gratitude to the media personnel present here who do the needful coverage for publication to the wider world. No lecture is complete without the audience. I thank everyone present for the patience and active participation in the discussion. Lastly, I have a special mention of thanks to the staff of International Division. Since International Division had initiated the proposal and done all efforts to coordinate Madam Bedi's lecture, I thank all the staff members of International Division for their wholehearted cooperation. I thank all of you once again.
With that, we come to the end of the third of this lecture series, and I think we can all now safely adjourn for a much, much needed cup of tea. Thank you.